news briefing from the 255th National Meeting and Exposition at the American Chemical Society in New Orleans. We're joined today by Dr. Seth Cohen from the University of California, San Diego. He's studying how to tweak to a small molecule drug can help in the production of new flu antiviral therapies. Dr. Cohen?
Hi, I'm really happy to be here, and I want to thank the ACS for doing interesting work. We've been working on inhibitors of a class of enzymes called metalloenzymes. These are found throughout biology, from humans down
to animals,
and they make very good drug targets. So we've been focused on one that could help ameliorate the flu condition. This shows the structure of one of the molecules that we developed actually down in the active site of this enzyme called heminuclease. It's part of the viral, key component of the viral life cycle of the flu virus. So this protein is required for the flu virus life cycle because the virus itself can't replicate on its own. It needs to hijack the replication system of the host cell, the human cell, in order to reproduce itself. And so this enzyme plays a key role in doing that. Yeah. So if you can block it, then the virus can't hijack the human host cell's genetic reproduction system and can't propagate. And it's also, this enzyme is completely ubiquitous across all flu strains. It can't be mutated at this active site where these metals are bound, shown as the sort of beige sphere or gray spheres there. And so it makes it a really good target because, of course, one of the issues with any virus, including the flu virus, are the different mutations and strains that come up. And this target really can't be evaded by a mutation. The virus really needs it. So this was a molecule we developed. We published, a student in my lab, Cy Friedel, published a paper in 2016 where we developed some of these small molecule, drug-like molecules for inhibiting this enzyme. We had some really good results then. But by focusing on how this molecule binds to the metal, and metal is critical for the reaction that the enzyme performs, we realized we weren't really fully exploiting the interactions between the drug and the metal, and that even just a small tweak, just adding a few atoms, we thought could enhance this. And what we found, much to our surprise, is it enhanced it far more than we ever expected. So just by adding a few atoms, that there's actually two metals in this active site next to each other. We were binding one in the original study. So just by adding a few atoms, we were able to bind both, sort of grabbing onto both handles, and it increased the activity of these compounds tremendously by orders of magnitude. And so that was sort of the exciting finding for us that we're writing up right now that hopefully published in the ACS journal. So the other, since I put my coworkers up here, I'd like to highlight them. So Cy was the synthetic chemist, organic chemist that led the project, generated a lot of ideas in terms of designing the compounds. And then Dr. Christine Morrison is a postdoc in my lab, and Ben Dick is another grad student, and they did a lot of the structural biology in the lab. So actually determining the structures of these molecules in the active site of the enzyme to help us realize we weren't fully exploiting things and how to design things better so that Cy can then make new molecules that fit the sort of hand and glove type fit better than we could before. And we didn't really have the capability. I'm trained as an inorganic and organic chemist. And so we didn't have that structural biology capability. So I want to give Sue Morrison and Ben a lot of credit for being able to purify, crystallize, and structurally characterize these inhibitors. So it allowed us to really do a much more precise design of the molecules as we move forward. I guess we'll continue on. So one thing I'd like to highlight as well is that my lab for about 15 years has been developing sort of these new strategies to inhibit metalloenzymes, which again are widely found throughout nature. Pretty much almost any disease you can think of, from the flu to HIV, to antibiotics, to cancer, to systematic diseases, involve metalloenzymes at some stage. And they're actually highly under-targeted as a class, like potential drug targets. And so a former graduate student of mine, David Huerta, and a local biologist, Zach Zimmerman, and myself co-founded a company called Forge Therapeutics a couple years ago. And they're now commercializing this whole strategy that we've developed in terms of going after these metalloenzyme targets. And like any startup, it was a struggle for quite some time, but last April, we were one of the companies that was awarded CARB-X funding, in the first round of CARB-X. I'm not sure if you're familiar with that, but it was CARB-X is a public-private partnership. It stands for Combating Antibiotic Resistance Bacteria Accelerator X. And it's a public-private partnership between the US and the UK, funded by the Wellcome Trust in Barda. It's administered, I believe, out of, if I get this wrong, I'd be in big trouble, either Boston College or Boston University, I can't remember which off the top of my head. And they are solely committed to providing, in total, I think about $400 million in funding for specifically for combating antibiotic-resistant bacteria. And so Forage is very fortunate. Their focus right now is on antibiotics and using the strategy we developed, same type of strategy we've used for endonuclease and the paper I'll be presenting later today. They're using it to go after an antibiotic target called LPSC, which is very important in gram-negative antibiotic-resistant bacteria. And so CARB-X recognized that last April, granted them approximately $8 million. It was actually the largest award CARB-X gave in their first round to the smallest company that was awarded anything in that first round. So we're quite proud of that. This is a local San Diego, homegrown. We're all from the area. Kids now on the soccer field is when he basically got started. So this has been a very exciting thing for me because I've been working in this area for 15 years and actually see ideas get translated, potentially, hopefully, someday in the clinic. It's been really exciting to see a former graduate student really lead that charge is even more gratifying. Oh, there's some bonus slides here. Okay. So yeah, this is just another structure, one of the antiviral compounds that we've developed, again, bound in the active site. And I can see from here. So the key is, it's hard for me to point out without a slide or something like that, or a pointer, but you can see the two gray spheres at the bottom of sort of this mesh, right? The mesh defines the electron density where we can see where the inhibitor is. And you can see the two gray spheres, and those are the two side of this enzyme. Again, and they're really the heart of this machine that allows it to do the chemistry it needs to do to steal the human machinery. And so you see above those manganese ions, sort of two red rods. Those are two oxygen atoms from the drug. So the drug is the part in the stick, in gray sticks, bound to the active site. And there's two little red rods at the bottom that are bound to the metal ion on the right. And that's what we initially had. When we realized grasp sort of capture the metal on the left, that would probably add a lot of activity to the compound. So we built in, you can see on the sort of left side of the molecule, two more red rods, one of which is facing the metal ion. And that little addition added, again, something like 100 or 1,000 fold more activity to the compound. Matter of fact, these compounds became so active compared to our first round that the typical biological assays you do to evaluate these compounds were not sensitive enough. We couldn't actually tell how tight they were binding because the compounds were so good. And so we had to use a different method called a thermal shift method to determine how tight they were, which is actually a pretty interesting method. And it shows that these were, as far as we could tell, the most effective, or most tightly binding, I should say, inhibitors of this enzyme today. I should also mention it's a validated target, this endonuclease target, Shionogi, a large Japanese pharma company. Actually, CNN News just had an article on this, I think just in the last couple of weeks. Shionogi has a compound in the clinic, first in class, for this target. It actually shares some design features with our molecule, so not unsurprisingly so. And it, I believe, just got approved in Japan for treating the flu, and is in, I believe, phase 3 clinical trials here in the U.S. I shouldn't say the press conference, don't quote me on that, but it's something like that. I wish I could see in the news article. It's probably a better reference than that. But the good thing is it validates that there's really a lot of interest in this target, and it would be a good opportunity to help individuals who are susceptible, and particularly susceptible when flu comes around. So obviously we have inoculation, we have vaccine, but especially this was a good year to sort of highlight, right? The vaccine was not very effective this year. It was particularly ineffective, and so particularly the elderly, the young, and the immunocompromised can still be quite vulnerable to the flu. So that's what compounds like this would be for those more susceptible individuals that might succumb to an otherwise routine flu infection.
Oh, very interesting. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for your time and your interest. Appreciate it.
Well, we'll move on to the Q&A portion. I'd like to ask for any of you here in the room and online to please state your name and affiliation before you ask your question. Do you have any questions? She's
Beth O'Driscoll-Lutz from Chemistry and Industry magazine. I guess, can I just ask for some clarification of, so you've actually improved the potency by binding to this extra manganese. Can you say a little bit about what these red ligands are, how exactly you improve that binding, and also something more about the test methods that you carried out and the results that you got in order to see that improved potency?
Sure. It would be okay if I use the traveling mic so I could actually go to the board and point these things out. It would be easier than just describing it. Is that okay?
Let's see. Are you ready?
I could end the sound pretty right, but I don't have a pointer in the slide. I don't know what to do with myself. So, so let me highlight what we added. So, these are the two manganese ions in the active site. All the sticks here, sort of green, those are the residues from the protein that are holding those manganese in place to utilize them. Right? So, these are amino acid residues from the enzyme holding them in place. Our drug, which I probably should have provided a better figure without the mesh just shows sort of the quality of the work. Our drug is the compound here where the carbons are colored gray and then nitrogen blue is typical and oxygen red. So the first group of compounds that we studied basically sort of looked like that. They were missing this component here. And so to the best of our knowledge, actually we didn't find this out until after the fact when we hired Christine Morrison and Ben Dickey in the lab and were able to do the structures. But we presumed that they were only binding to this one metal, right? There's this oxygen atom, so these are both oxygen atoms from the drug. One binds the manganese here, the other binds the manganese there, and this one actually bridges between the two, which is not uncommon for some molecules like this. But we thought, well, there's extra room around this metal, the second metal ion, to capture more interactions with it. And the thing that we were very excited about is we knew as inorganic chemists that it would be simple just to add a few atoms and potentially capture that interaction. And very often, right, if you want to get the type of improvement and activity we've seen here, you might have to add a lot of atoms, which adds to the molecular weight and can make the drug-like properties of the molecule worse. But here we thought we could just add a few. And so we added this group here, which is just a simple carboxylic acid group. And so the carboxylic acid forms this chelate now, right, this six-member ring, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, with that metal ion. And so now both of these metal ions are what we call or held in a chelate. Right? Chelate is a Greek, is a common organic term, right? It's a Greek word for claw, like a crab's claw. And so we're grasping onto both of these metals very tightly. And so just by adding three atoms, like I said, I think we improved the activity by a factor of 1,000 or something like that. Which is pretty, I think, pretty great, even from a medicinal chemistry standpoint, just to add a few atoms and get that much increased activity. The method we used to characterize this, which has become, so I'm an inorganic chemist by training, and I'm trying to become a self-trained medicinal chemist, and so is my whole lab. And so a technique that's become really popular in sort of screening compounds in medicinal chemistry in the last couple of years are these sort of fluorescence thermal shift assays. And what they're really interesting assays, what they do is they actually look at how these molecules stabilize the protein. So when these things bind, they actually make the entire protein more stable. This doesn't always work, but it works for a lot of small molecules bound to proteins. And so the way you can think of this experiment is, it's like very precisely cooking an egg, right? So you take an egg white, you put it in your frying pan, and when the egg goes from translucent to white, that's because the proteins have unfolded, right? They what we call denatured. So this experiment is in many ways very similar to this, except we're very precisely recording the temperature at which the egg turns white. And when you add these drug-like molecules to bind to the enzyme, they cook, if you will, at a higher temperature because the drug actually makes the entire structure more stable. And so what we could do is once the regular assay we normally use was no longer sensitive enough, we started using this thermal method. And what we could see is that our better improved compounds, they increase the temperature at which the protein melts or denatures by a lot more than the other compounds for which we had hard values based on the older assay. And so that was the way we were able to evaluate this. And then the paper we're drafting right now, that'll be in my talk this afternoon, you could sort of linearly extrapolate a correlation between inhibition values using the old assay and shifts in melting temperature using the new assay, and you could extrapolate how tight these things were binding. And that's where we came up with these estimates of what ended up being picomolar activity, which is really, really active. For most small molecule drugs, we only need something in the 10 nanomolar range Did I ask you a question?
Hi, this is Kat from Chem Stewart. So I was wondering, is this metalloenzyme with two manganese, is that very specific for this virus or for any virus, or are there other enzymes in the body that are similar? So just thinking of side effects, these kind of things.
Yeah, it's a great question. So no, it's not unique, but humans don't have any analog to this enzyme. So it's considered in that regard a safe target. Now in terms of the broader question, no, this motif actually is very, very common, particularly in a lot of viral enzymes that involve in one form or another chemistry on nucleic acids, whether it be RNA or DNA, which are very often critical to the life cycle of these organisms. So I would say actually another example of validation for this as a target, there's several, I think three now FDA approved drugs for HIV that target an enzyme in HIV called HIV integrase, which uses a dinuclear magnesium active site that is not the same, but in terms of the metal features, is not wholly distinct from this enzyme. And those drugs, raltegravir, dolutegravir, and the third one's eltegravir that have been all FDA approved, those drugs also bind in the active site in some regards similar to this. They end up binding both metal ions tightly to get a lot of their activity. So this is becoming actually a motif, I would say, in these viral therapeutics is to go after these active sites. And so it plays well for my lab's interests. Well, like I said, the most advanced compound that I'm aware of is the compound from Shionogi. The name is escaping me. It's got a rather long generic name that off the top of my head, I can't pull it off. But yeah, I think it is very far along. Like I said, it's either already approved in Japan and phase 3 late studies here. And so I think that's probably the most encouraging sign. I know that just in my travels and going to conferences that Shionogi is certainly not the only large pharma company interested in endonuclease as a target. And, you know, my sense is that these pharma companies validate these targets much better than my small lab will. So I think that there's quite good validation at this point. I also think the success of like HIV integrase drugs, although a different target, there's enough of a relation that I think it's getting people excited about this area. Integrase was interesting because if you look at the history of HIV, there were sort of several canonical targets. There was the reverse transcriptase, the HIV protease, and then this integrase. They were all seen as sort of three key components of the viral life cycle. And it was integrase that took the longest to develop a drug for. The first drug, which was raltegravir, came out of Merck. And it was FDA approved, I think, in 2007. It was nearly 20 years after the first HIV drug was approved. And I think our lab's contention is a big reason it took so long was because of the metal active site. This is not something that, as an overall class, is well represented in small molecule drugs. So even though about 50% of all enzymes contain metals in their active site, less than 5% of FDA-approved drugs target metal enzymes. And I think how these molecules interact with metal active sites is challenging and not something that is necessarily well entrenched in the culture of medicinal chemistry. So, raltegravir took a long time to develop, but I think now that that's in the clinic, and very successful molecule, by the way, is why there's several Me Too compounds now out there that have better dosing regimens and things like this, I think it's really opening up the field for targeting these metal-dependent antivirals. I think it's really proving their clinical value. So I do think it's there, and honestly, that's what the company I was involved with, or I am involved with Forge, is all about. It's really about trying to exploit these opportunities that have sort of been latent for a long time.
So in what way does your new small molecule differ from the Shionogi one that's almost approved?
So the overall structure is quite different, but it shares a lot of similar features. The Shionogi compound has a metal binding core that actually has many similarities to what ours has. But the overall structure is very different. It involves 2-3 fused ring systems, and it's actually administered as a prodrug. to avoid metabolism. So there's things about it that are different. There are things about it that are similar. What I would say is we're optimistic that, so if I have the heavy atom count in my head right, our molecule is significantly smaller than theirs, and our activity, I would guess, at least on the enzyme, we don't have viral activity yet, we're getting that. But on the enzyme, I would say it's gonna be pretty hard to beat. And so I think maybe we have better atom economy here, which in the long run gives us more flexibility in terms of maybe engineering in better drug-like properties in the long run. So, yeah, but I'm very happy to see, you know, companies sort of validating the target. That means a lot to our lab, because a small academic lab can't do that. You need big pharma to do that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I think that's about all the time we have for questions. The archived session of this, the archived version of this session will soon be available at bit.ly/ACSLive_NOLA. Please join us for our next press conference at 10 a.m. today on commercial uses of great waste. Thank you very much.